Welcome to The Fallen State. I'm Jesse Lee Peterson. Today I want to talk about the power of the mind. I have with me Mike Cernovich, lawyer, filmmaker, and author of The Guerrilla Mindset. Mike, thanks for coming, man.
Always a pleasure to see you again.
And thank you for sitting in for me on the radio show as well.
Yeah, it was fun.
Why did you call it Guerrilla Mindset? Why Guerrilla?
Because it was an ironic and surprising way to get attention. Because people think, well, mindset, you think of Zen Buddhism or Christianity or meditation. But to be different and to stand out, I go, you know what, I'm just going to call it Guerrilla Mindset.
You were a Christian, you grew up a Christian, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at some point you left Christianity,
mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Correct.
Why did you leave?
The hypocrisy and the lying and the behavior that I saw, the judgmental nature of a lot of people. There's so many people who they're more worried about the sinfulness of other people rather than worrying about their own sinful nature.
Were your father and mother Christians?
Yeah, and they're great Christians, actually. If more people were Christian like my dad, he doesn't really care what other people do. He loves me and he thinks I am going to go to hell, sincerely believes that, and he doesn't want me to go to hell. I know his beliefs, but he isn't going around judging people. I wish more people would just be more tolerant Christians.
I never understood how did people know who would go to hell and go to heaven when that decision is made by God only. Even when I go to funerals, I hear people say, oh, he's going to heaven. Where did that come from when they decide who's going to heaven and who's not?
Yeah, and it varies based on faith traditions. And I was in a more fire and brimstone type church. Yeah. I think it's interesting that people, we want to believe that we know the answers because the alternative is too terrifying, which
right.
is that we don't know that much.
Right.
We don't have as much control as we think.
And so you say your father is not judgmental. Is your mother, or was she judgmental at one point?
No, they weren't.
She's like your father?
Yeah, they're live and let live kind of people.
Oh, okay. And so you left Christianity, and where did you go?
I definitely went more full atheism, secularism. But you find that ultimately is not connected. There is a vibe in the world. You can feel spirit. There's something in our collective humanity that lets us know that there is good and there is evil.
What did that feel like to be an atheist, meaning not believing in God?
Well, the reason I don't identify as atheist either is because they're just as smug and judgmental. Oh, you believe in God, you must be stupid. But meanwhile, I went to a law school with a lot of very intelligent people. I've known a lot of people who are legitimate intellectuals who do believe in God. So I'm thinking to the atheists, why are you so smug and judgmental of people? Too, if a lot of intelligent people disagree with you, then maybe there is something to it. Or at the very least, there's no need to snark at everybody who disagrees with you.
Right. And so are you a judgmental person?
I think we all are, ultimately.
How about you?
Me personally?
Yes.
In a way, but I'm more of a isolationist. I'm judgmental of people, but only in the sense that I don't want to be around that. But I'm not going to go around and tell people that they're evil and they're bad and I don't like the way they live.
Is there a good way to judge people without being negative about it?
Well, that's where I changed. That's where like guerrilla mindset kind of set in, which is I used to be judgmental and negative of people. And that's probably, you know, like they say, the things that you don't like in other people
right.
are largely a reflection
Move
of
yourself.
The things that you do yourself, right?
Right.
So when I say, well, I don't like judgmental people, well, probably because I was unduly judgmental. And I realized that I don't have everything figured out, so it doesn't make a lot of sense for me to rant and rave and be frustrated with people who don't see the world the way I do because I don't know all that much. I'd like to think I do. I know a few things well, but the world is complicated.
I've come to realize that I know nothing, and I'm happy. There's no stress when you know that you don't know anything. And when you know of yourself, you can do nothing. There's no stress, and yet life seemed to happen anyway, and in amazing ways, too. So I'm at that point where I don't judge anyone. I just agree with people, but it's not personal. You know, I don't feel anything about it.
That's what shocks a lot of people because I can be very aggressive, but anybody that I've insulted or went after or whatever, if somebody came in and we were hanging out, I would feel no animosity
right.
towards the person.
That's right.
Yeah, I don't sit around seething about people and being angry about people because, again, that makes a negative mindset for yourself, too.
Sure
if you're
does.
Judgmental, and you're angry and you're taking things personally, then that's going to affect how you live.
Guerrilla mindset, how to control your thoughts and emotions to live life on your terms. Let me ask first, why did you come up with that?
There's a lot packed into that short subtitle, which is live life on your terms. That's what most people want to do. That really is what it's about. You want to live life as you like. And then thoughts and emotions. You talk to people, they say, my thoughts are spiraling out of control. That's a very common phrase. Well, why is that? Well, because they don't know how to control their thoughts. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, let's say I don't like you. And then I think about you. And then I get angry and I get worked up. And then my wife comes over and says, Michael, you know, we need to do something for the baby. I'm probably going to scream at her. So we talk about ways that you can control your thought patterns to stop thinking about negative things and start thinking about more positive things.
As a matter of fact, that's what Christianity is all about, is overcoming the thoughts, the thought process. You know, God said, don't think about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, all that stuff. Think on these things. Meaning don't think on hating someone and don't worry about what you're going to eat, where you're going to live and all that. You know, think about things that are good for you, good for the soul.
Well, yeah,
a lot of Christians don't do that.
Well, yeah, the Bible even says meditate on Scripture daily,
right,
which is just a recognition that if you're waking up and you're reading your Bible every morning, you're probably going to have some kind of better day than if you just wake up without any kind of connection to anything.
Is it possible to control your thoughts and emotions?
Of course.
You control, and how does one control his thoughts or emotions and emotions?
So here's the way I break it down. Right now I'm angry. Okay, what am I looking at when I'm angry? Well, I'm looking at a thought or a person or something.
Right.
Well, instead of just stop being angry, which isn't a helpful advice at all, I say, well, I'm just going to think about something else. And I'm going to redirect that emotional energy and that conscious energy and the thought energy to a different subject. And then eventually what happens is the anger dissipates naturally. It's the same way that people say if you're having an anxiety attack. People say, oh my God, I'm having an anxiety attack. I'm freaking out. How can I stop? Well, just breathe. Well, how is breathing going to stop an anxiety attack? Well, because you're not focused on the anxiousness. You're not focused on whatever's making you anxious.
You're not getting into it.
You're focusing on your breath. And then by focusing on your breath, that energy is being used in a more productive manner. And then suddenly you're not having any kind of anxiety.
So I know that you're married. Let's say you wake up in the morning, you are feeling good, you had a good night's sleep, and you open your eyes and there your wife is looking in your face and said, you were dreaming about Louise. And right away you get mad because you just woke up fresh and ready to go. Now you're ticked off. You're driving down the road angry and thinking about what she did to you. She messed up your whole day already. How do you get out of that?
That's a choice. I even have that mentioned in my book, how we take a very passive outlook on our mood. Why are you accepting that passive state of affairs? Why are you giving people the control over your emotions? So you have to be careful and mindful of who you allow into your life.
Yeah.
That's especially who you're waking up next to.
That's right.
It's your friends. If I have friends of mine who, if they just want to gossip and be bicker and say negative things, then I just don't talk to them.
People
say, well, that's cruel. No, it isn't, because it's actually cruel that they want me to feel as crappy about the world as they want to feel.
Yep.
So you need to come up to my level. I'm not going to go down to yours. But then what you talked about is a textbook case of spiraling out of control. I woke up. I was in a good mood. My wife put me in a bad mood. Now I'm in the car angry. And then you're thinking, oh, I'm going to work. I don't like it. My boss doesn't respect me. How did my life end? That's where you start just a very small thing and then you have a cascade of negative emotions where you just want to just think about something else. So if you're in a bad mood, which happens to everybody, just listen to music that doesn't put you in a bad mood.
So as you're driving down the road, you listen to some nice music that relaxes you for a minute there, or you start thinking about pleasant things, then those thoughts that cause you to become angry at your wife disappear after a while?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's because it's a matter of focus. Whatever you're looking at is whatever you're paying attention to.
Right.
Whatever you're paying attention to, and it's all been proven scientifically, whatever you're paying attention to is what you think is important. So the news is a great example of it. We think, well, this is really important.
Right.
Well, because our focus is being directed to something that may or may not even matter or may not even be true, but because we're focused on it, we give it more emphasis and more priority.
Do you hear voices in your mind? Do you hear your own voice? Or other people's voices?
Yeah, we all do. That's why there's a chapter on self-talk. there's always that inner monologue going on.
Is that normal to be listening or hearing these voices? Because a lot of people hear those voices and they believe in those voices. Some Christians think it's the voice of God. And so they believe in those voices. Should they believe in them or avoid them?
Well, you want to control the voices. You want to control the conversations in your head. Where did the voices in your head come from? Well, they came from the way your parents talked to you, the way society talked to you, the way your teachers talked to you, the way the culture talked to you, the way the news talked to you. Most of the voices in our head aren't our own thoughts. So then these voices in our head are often telling us, you're not good enough, you don't have enough.
Right.
And then you think, well, why do I even care? Well, I care because these voices in my head are telling me to care. Where those voices come from? They came from culture. So you need to be mindful, too, of what you allow inside your to go on inside your own head.
Some of those voices seem negative, and some seem positive. Should we listen to the positive ones?
Well, you should listen to the helpful ones. You should listen to the control, the ones that actually, that's why it's take control of your thoughts and emotions. So if a voice in your head is telling you, usually negative ones, that you're never good enough, you always make this mistake, you mess this one up again, that isn't getting you anywhere.
But how about the ones that tell you that you're wonderful and that you're just all that? And you get into that, you believe that, and as soon as you believe it, then someone else come along and remind you that you're not that wonderful. Now you're up and then you're down.
Well, reality is always going to push back. That's what I tell people is, if you think you're wonderful, then reality will tell you if you are or aren't.
Yeah.
There's a difference between self-confidence and self-esteem. You look at the young kids today and you think, idiots. But I was an idiot like that too. You have unearned feelings of entitlement, unearned feelings of accomplishment. So it's better to, instead of saying, I'm great, saying, well, if I work hard, I can achieve great things.
What were you like prior to this technique?
I was definitely more stressed out. I was very neurotic.
Okay.
So I was a Woody Allen type. Just, oh my God, you know, am I ever going to make money? Am I ever going to succeed? Am I going to be able to pay my bills? And then I realized that I was being neurotic because I was focused on low probability but catastrophic events.
Mm.
So neurosis, again, is the product of focus. If you're neurotic, that means you're focusing on things that cause anxiety. So rather than focus on, could this air conditioner fall from the ceiling, I just focus on something else. It could be something mundane or profound. I'm not always thinking philosophy or Aristotle or something like that. A lot of times I'm just thinking about my breathing or counting the steps I'm taking or focusing on my posture, focusing on something that keeps me grounded and present in the moment.
How did you become aware enough to do that, to start focusing and breathing? How did that happen?
I started taking a log of when I would have a good day and when I had a bad day.
Okay.
So if you have a good day, you say, I feel good right now. Why do I feel good? Well, you probably had 8 hours of sleep or however much sleep you had. You probably weren't around negative people yesterday. You probably were doing work that you didn't hate at the very least.
So the technique then is to just take a moment to check out what you're thinking and feeling, and in that moment, things start to change for you.
Right.
Right. Do you have anger?
Of course.
You have anger. And where did your anger come from?
Don't know. That's what I mean. Emotions appear. Largely, it is if you're getting enough sleep, if you're hydrated well, if you're taking care of yourself, going to the gym, you're going to feel less anger. But usually, anger comes from, I call it ego expectations entitlement. Ego tells me that I have these expectations about the world, that I'm entitled to the world. So, my ego would say, Mike, why aren't you a world famous A-list actor? Well, your ego tells you that you're entitled to that. So you expect to have that. And when you don't have it, then you become frustrated, and frustration leads to anger.
Mm.
So when you change that and you take control of your ego, you eliminate feelings of entitlement, then your expectations about the world change, and then you tend to be happier with what you have in life.
I had anger for a long time growing up, and when I had this anger, it controlled what I thought and felt. And I remember as a kid not having anger, so I was in control. But when I started to resent my parents, then I became an angry person. And so the thoughts and things would have control over my emotions. I would think, feel, and act out. And long story short, once I forgave my parents, then that spirit of anger left. So I no longer have that in me now. And when thoughts come, I can see them coming before they overtake me to get me to feel a certain way and act out a certain way. Also, I have, as a result of not having the anger, I have perfect peace within. I don't have that conflict anymore. And it is allowing me to deal with things properly, not overreact, to have control of myself. I also have no impression of myself. I don't see myself as good or bad, right or wrong. And so as a result, I'm able to move forward. Are you talking about kind of the same thing?
Yeah, there's a lot going on there, which is, one, you said that you're now able to recognize when you're about to get angry and you just
redirect
it.
When the thoughts are coming, yeah.
Yeah, so it's the same thing as if you're in a, you know, marriage where you're, you know, there's nothing going on, then you don't have dinner with the beautiful woman, you know, because it is a lot easier to say no to dinner with a beautiful woman than it is to say no when she hands you the hotel key. Let's go back to the hotel. So people say, well, how can I avoid the temptation? Well, you avoid the temptation by avoiding the situation. And that's why, again, I still talk about and cite about the Bible, which is so much of resisting temptation is not getting to the point where you really have to resist really hard, is avoiding the entire pattern.
Do you know your purpose in life? And is that, should we know our purpose?
Life purpose is going to always change for everybody. My purpose in life is to share the message of guerrilla mindset and to preserve Western civilization.
Self-taught. When you say self, though, is that us or is that another identity that's made a home inside of you?
Who knows, right? But with self-talk, I look at it this way. If you're going to talk to yourself the way you would talk to a friend. So again, I can't speak for everybody, but for the most part, when you make a mistake, you're like, God, I made this mistake again. I'm always making this mistake. Well, if a friend came to you and said, hey, I did this, you wouldn't start screaming at your friend, you always make this mistake.
That's a very good point.
You would just say, oh, well, yeah, you made the mistake, and yeah, here's that is annoying.
Move on.
Here's how you can do it. Yeah. Why don't we talk to ourselves like that then, too?
And why is that then? Why are we so hard on ourselves?
Because that's what society is ingrained in us. You're not taught as a kid to work your way through problems. We're told by society, here's a test, study for the test, take the test. But that isn't real life. Real life is dynamic, it's changing. You have to figure things out contextually. You don't learn that in any school.
You believe that there is good and evil?
Right.
And why do you believe that?
You can sense it, you can sense an aura, and you can reason your way that. You can reason your way through it too. There's an innocence, for example, that children have.
Why do we lose that?
The world, man, the world is fallen. We live in a fallen state.
So do our parents cause us to lose that? Because most of the time, not all, but they're out of control too, fighting with one another. You know, the fathers are weak, the mothers are angry about it, so they put pressure on you. Does that cause us to lose that?
Yeah, everybody's a mess.
Yeah.
That's why you said you forgive your parents. You know, you have to forgive your parents. I know so many people my age or older, and that's actually one way that I won't be friends with a person anymore, is if you're still talking about your parents and how they were bad parents, then we're just not going to work as friends or acquaintances or business partners, because your parents did the best they could with their messed up minds. And
that's
now
right.
you're mad at them, but they did what they could. They didn't deliberately want to harm you. That was the best they could. And if you can't accept that and you want to dwell on that, then you're not going to move forward.
Do you believe in God?
I don't know that I believe in God. I definitely believe there's something.
But you're not sure if it's God.
Right.
So you believe that there's something like what?
There's you can feel it. You know, you can feel the mood. You can feel the mood in a room. You can feel the mood when you're out in nature.
Right.
When you open yourself up to the world, you can feel that there's something there, and that something is more than what we perceive.
I know you talk about body language. Why is body language important?
Because it's also tied to mood. So if you sit like this, you're gonna be in a more different mood. That's why I tell people to analyze how you feel and then your body language when you feel. Example is anger. Anger is a forward moving emotion. So if I'm angry at you, I'm leaning forward, you know, I'm going. So a lot of times instead of saying, well, stop being angry at Jesse, I would just say, no, just sit back for a minute. Just change your body language. And then when you change your body language, you hijack. Because a lot of this stuff is instinctual, which is another way it was gorilla mindset. Is a lot of this is based on our primate brain, our monkey brain.
Yeah.
If you're moving forward, that triggers a lot of limbic response that makes you feel a certain way. So if you're leaning forward because you're angry, and then you lean back, well, you're leaning back, you're telling your limbic system there is no threat. It's just that simple change in posture makes you go from being angry to being relaxed. All the answers are in our ancestors.
Yeah.
The wisdom's there, but nobody's ever taken it systematically. So people say, well, take a step back. Well, why would they tell you to take a step back? But with men, especially young men, they take too many steps back. You got to teach young men, you need to take a step forward,
right.
Actually.
Yeah.
You need to have more assertive body language. You need to convince your mind that you can accomplish things. So we're way too laid back now.
Have you ever resented your parents?
Never.
You never resent. You've never been angry at your parents at all?
No, because you got to realize that they can only do what they can do.
But when you're young, though, you're relying on them and you look to them to be perfect in life until you get older and understand it's not the case. So were your parents perfect?
No, I never expected that as a kid.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, the only I'll give you an example. They're like, we would have pizza night and my family on Friday. And we would always order taco pizza, my dad would. And I hated taco pizza. And I was just like, why do we have taco pizza? None of us kids like it.
Yeah.
And then I went and got a job with my grandmother as a janitor where my dad worked. He worked in a factory. And she goes, oh, here, I'll show you where your dad works. And she took me out to the factory floor. And I said, well, my dad can have whatever pizza he wants on a Friday. There's soot up to your waist and dirt everywhere, and
yeah.
It's loud, very dangerous. And I go, well, you know, he can do whatever he wants on a Friday. They made me they made us go to church all the time, too much, but that's just a little childhood crybaby stuff. My younger brothers were angry because we were poor, and I think they had resentment for that. My older sister had a little bit of resentment because we grew up poor.
But you didn't.
No.
And so, are you like a special person? I mean, like
no. You know, it's a hard answer because I had a tough childhood. And things like I was bullied, childhood bullying. But
oh, you were.
Yeah. But I learned just through doing martial arts and things that if you do work hard, if you do apply yourself, if you do actually put the work in, then you are going to see gradual improvement. So I focused more on those existential threats. So we grew up poor, but I didn't really have time to resent my family because I had like five kids trying to like jump me everywhere I went.
What is a man? Let me first ask, are you a man?
Yes.
And what is a man?
A man imposes his will on reality.
Oh, okay.
The imposition of will, creating life in your image, creating reality in your image, that's the essence of masculinity.
I never heard it put that way before, but that is true.
I've thought a lot about it. And of course, the world is going to impose its will on you, and
right.
It's always a wrestling match. It's not a one-way conversation, but that's the way. As a man, you're not done until you've given up. When you've given up and then you quit, then you're not a man anymore.
Is there a difference between men and women?
Of course.
What's the difference?
Women, they rule indirectly, men rule directly.
Oh.
So the women get their power through men, and they're happier when they get their power through men.
Right.
But if you're a man and you're just like pretty good, you're nothing. You're basically garbage. You don't exist. A woman isn't going to say, well, that man is like just sort of like, okay, pretty good. Well, I'm going to buy him stuff and take care of him and try to live a nice life with him. It doesn't work that way. But if you're a woman and you're just like pretty good, then you're going to find a man, you know, who is going to, actually, men will throw themselves on you. You know, and if you're an attractive woman, all you have to do is show up and men are going to buy you things. The world kind of opens doors for you. But if you're a man, you have to open the doors for yourself.
Yeah.
Nobody is going to give you anything.
That's right. Have you always been a man?
Probably not.
Okay.
I think that when I was blaming the world more for what I didn't have or wondering why I didn't have certain things.
I know you're married. What attracted you to your wife?
Good cheer, good humor, a happy nature. I didn't think I would ever be married.
Again. You didn't?
No.
Why not?
Because I like a lot of freedom, and you're in a relationship with anybody, you do give up freedom.
And how do you feel about that?
You focus. She adds a levity to my life, a certain happiness, a certain lightheartedness. When I'm by myself, I enjoy being by myself, but I become very serious and almost too serious.
Oh, okay.
So I could be living in a attic somewhere, and I could probably become a recluse. I could probably get really weird. So instead of focusing on, well, have you lost a little bit of freedom, which is true, and that's another thing I teach in Guerrilla Mindset, is things can be simultaneously true, but you can focus on different things. So you could say, well, I've lost a little bit of freedom, I'm resentful, I'm angry, and everything else. Or you could just say, I've lost a little bit of freedom, but she's very lighthearted, she's a happy person, I'm a more cheerful person around here, her, so I'm going to focus on that aspect of it.
You have children?
On the way.
One on the way.
Yeah, and that's another example of focus.
Yeah.
You do the research on it, it's a rough year, year and a half. They're screaming, diapers need changing, you're not going to get much sleep, and then people focus on, oh, I'm tired, oh, I'm stressed out, or oh, my partner isn't working hard enough, or not enough is being done, but you can focus on that, or you can just focus on the love that you have for your child. So again, it's simultaneously true that having children suck. It's also simultaneously true that having children is a great joy. It's your choice what you focus on.
So do you speak your mind to your wife? You don't hold back?
Oh, definitely not.
That's good. Because a lot of men won't say what's really
Well, because they're afraid, they're timid, and they're afraid she'll leave, or she'll get angry, or oh, she's going to go off the temper. I can't tell my wife this because she'll throw a fit.
Yeah.
And, I'd been married before, and that was more my mindset.
Oh, okay.
And that's the mindset of 9 out of 10 men, actually, is that most men live in sheer terror of their wives.
I know.
Even the most powerful men in the world
live
in fear of their wives.
And women don't like weak men like that.
Right.
They'd rather have you stand up and be yourself and speak your mind. They might fight you on it, but they appreciate that about you.
Yeah, women love dominant and assertive men.
Yeah.
That's what they want. And that's another thing I learned too about being a man in relationships is, I would know all these powerful men, speaking of body language and men and relationships, just to tie everything together is, we've all seen the guy freeze up looking at his phone. You're like, what's wrong? My wife, she's telling me I need to be home, and oh God, and his whole body language changes, his whole posture changes.
Right.
Well, oftentimes these are what you would consider alpha males. These are the CEOs of large banks, the CEOs of companies, very powerful people, but they're living in terror of their wives at home.
Yeah.
And
I know
I won't
preachers
live that way.
Who are like that too.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They're running a congregation, people look up to them, they're charismatic, but boy, they get that text message and their whole demeanor and everything
that
changes.
That is so true.
Yeah.
Is your father a man?
Yeah, definitely.
He's always been a man.
Well, that's another way to define men. They had children too soon, and they were too poor, so he should have found other economic ways.
Oh, okay.
He should have figured out it out.
There was a riot in
Charlotte,
North Carolina, yesterday and last night. What do you think about that?
It's what the media wants. The media wants a race war. That's just the reality.
Yeah.
It's what we talked about early on in the show, focus, attention, thinking things are more important than not. If we care about black lives, we should care about single motherhood.
Yeah.
80% or 85% of children in the black community are born to single moms. Fact. We know that if you want to give the child the least chance of succeeding, single family homes are the way to do it. But you can't say that because that's misogynistic and it's racist. So if you say, well, black single moms are not doing a great job of raising their kids, you're never going to be on CNN because you hate women, you hate black people. So we can't have an honest conversation about what's going on there. So instead, what we do is we focus the black community's rage on something else.
Why do you think they are allowing these black people to riot and loot and burn down?
They want that. They want the people to be divided.
Yeah.
And of course you want the people to be divided.
Yeah.
Because then you can steal more money from the people.
Yeah.
So if you view government as not trying to help people, but instead how can a few people make billions of dollars, then everything that happens makes total sense.
Yeah.
Of course you want race riots. Of course you want race wars, because then you and the government can take on more power.
How do you see Black Lives Matter?
It's a hate group.
Yeah.
Undoubtedly a hate group. And it's funded by George Soros, who his whole life has done nothing but agitate and cause hate.
A lot of white people are afraid to speak the truth for fear of being called racist, and as a result, these people come into power. They intimidate white folks, they now run the White House. What would you say to white people about that?
It's a tough question because nobody wants to feel like they're a bad person, But I would say, look at who is calling you racist. Yeah. Look at who is making these judgments against you. And then you realize that the people calling you names are actually evil people, wicked people. So why would you let them judge you?
That's right. Mike, this has been fun. Did you have fun?
It's been my pleasure.
This is amazing, man. You are something else. Do they call you names and stuff? Or do you get threats?
Of course, I get all that stuff.
How do you deal with that?
You just have to the gorilla mindset, basically.
Who's going to win the election, Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton?
Donald Trump.
And why do you say Trump?
Because Trump's a man. I've always said that since July.
And what is wrong with Hillary?
Her health. She's corrupt. She has no will. She has no charisma. She has no aura. She has no spirituality. She's a wicked person. She's a far-left person. Everybody can feel that she is diseased of the body and of the mind.
Wow. That's deep.
That's true.
Now there's trouble bussing in from out of state, and the DA can't get no relief. Gonna be a rumble on a promenade, and the gambling commissioner's hanging on by the skin of his teeth. Everything dies, baby, that's a fact. But maybe everything that dies someday he comes back.
Next time on The Fallen State.
Why are white people so hated?
Throughout the history of the United States, white people have been in power. And I believe a lot of students who have been protesting, they feel that as minorities, they need to bunch together and fight that, overthrow the power.
So white people are being punished because they're empowered. But then isn't it white people who made it possible for others to come here?
I do agree with what you're saying, yeah.